everything is code. Everything is code in the sense that hackers mean when they say they write code. This realization that everything is code and code moving on many levels is more primary than the perception, for example, that things are made of space, time, matter, and energy. That's one level below code. The code codes for space, time, matter, and energy. It's much more like we're in a simulacrum, some kind of machine environment. And in fact, I like that idea because I've always sensed that the universe is a puzzle. Life is a problem to be solved. It's a conundrum. It's not what it appears to be. There are doors. There are locks and keys. There are levels. And if you get it right, somehow it will give way to something extremely unexpected.
Your social programming basically is an imprint. Instead of saying good or bad, it's basically which perception do you lean towards. If you lean towards a bad decision, then you end up with a bad perception. If you lean toward a good, then you end up with a good perception. This is all the social. And there's another where you interact without expecting either one. And then you wait for the perception of the world to come to you instead of your perception going to the world and interfering with the process of your path.
Everything that I have decided and defined about myself personally and everything outside of me is a story. It's a total story. And in my brain, there is a neural racetrack that has been formatted using this code that I wrote the story of Mark, the little I in. I wrote that story of me and defined everything internal and external, and then, you know, had that running for about 30 years. And until I evaluate the truth of that story, my experiences are going to be dictated by that story. And wherever I go, I take the expansiveness or restrictiveness of my story into that situation, whether it's a personal relationship, a business endeavor, a doctor's appointment, you know, going into the convenience store to get, you know, some milk, I mean, whatever. I take my story with me.
If someone's socially bound, then they bring in this social program to fortify who they are. If imprinting's not happening, then it stays on the level of your feeling, and you witness it, and then you reflect back through your voice, through how you speak, instead of thinking what you're going to say, you know what you're going to say. There's a big difference. It's not a script. If somebody comes into the room and their chakras or their energy centers are spinning in a way which is disruptive, I'll feel that in my body. So that's my body consciousness. So you may be presented with a pressure in your body and you represent that pressure. If just say that I'm fully a socialized being, then I'll integrate with a social factor that comes into the room through the person and be totally unaware of the spinning factors that are in my energy field. So there's a big difference between body consciousness and social interaction.
Just as the mind works by defining forms, geometries, structures, tree, rock, leaf, sky, earth, each one of those forms, each one of those ideas is like a shape that is in light inside of our consciousness. Our mind functions as like an electromagnetic field, right? We see brain waves pulsing through and moving through the brain. but there's actually standing wave field interactions that are occurring, literally holographic three-dimensional projections of ideas that are contained within our energy field. As we come to know the sources of each holographic projection, each one of the fractal elements of our experience of the whole universe that is actually contained within our own individual small energy field, we gain a language of engaging with all of those projections. As we come to understand our relationship with the universe through experiences, we realize that there are codes behind experiences themselves. There are literally root geometries and root structures of just pure color and light energy and form that actually inside them can contain huge libraries of experience. In other words, you might just see a six-pointed star, but that six-pointed star can transmit to you a huge library of emotional experience that you may have had. We may just see a geometry pop into our mind, and then all of a sudden, boom, there's this whole stream of consciousness and knowledge and understanding that comes with it, like a sigil. It becomes recognized as a language when we start to create things or start to transmit ideas using those projections that we have inside of our consciousness. The ability for us to focus on a single clear idea and hold that single clear idea and detail that single clear idea becomes literally our capacity level to manifest something very, very, very specifically. The more clearly you can see the house that you want in your mind, and the more detailed all of its elements, the more of those details will actually come into the manifestation when you make it happen.
When I say I don't want to have money problems anymore, what kind of picture do I make in my mind? Me having what? Money problems, which is going to microdose my energy with whatever vibration I consider having a money problem to be, which is going to help me manifest more what? More money problems. For everybody out there who knows what a vision board is, how many people that have made a vision board have put what they don't want on their vision board? I'm still waiting to meet somebody. You know, and I ask people. I ask people in sessions. I ask people in group sessions. Raise your hand if you've ever put some of what you don't want on your vision board. Everybody looks at me like I'm insane. And I want that, because I'm going to ask the next question is, why would you do that on your internal vision board? And to make it exponentially more potent, when I say I don't want to have money problems anymore, and 36 people hear me say that at one point in time or throughout the day, then those people have made 36 pictures of me with money problems. And when I realize that I am at all times enlisting people in my life to help me generate more of what I want or more of what I don't want based on how I speak, I got dedicated. I lived in a community that revolved around a fasting and detox facility. I worked there, and there were fantastic thinkers, great motivational individuals coming through with all kinds of gadgets and gizmos and detoxes ways of healing this thing and that thing and the other thing. And one thing that I saw that always delivered the goods at a very high level was living in truth. Okay, well, great. Well, how do I speak that way? Do I want to speak about, you know, what my dad didn't do? Is that being truthful? What he didn't do? Why would I make pictures of what my dad didn't do and then piss myself off about it and then blame him? Same thing goes for a kid. You know, don't fall down and hurt your knee. You know, or don't talk back to me. Don't be late for school. And every time I say that, they're going to make a picture of them being late for school. And so did I. And I irritate myself. And then I emotionally dump all over that little kid. after I've helped him make the picture of what I don't want him to do, and I think it's his fault, then there's soft language. And this is the cherry on the icing on the cake. By removing soft language, it demands ownership of whatever that I am observing, whether it's some shadow aspect of myself or a talent or an opportunity or whatever, because the truth slips out through maybes and possiblys, and you know, maybe I'm still angry at my dad. Yeah, I can think that thought for a long time and pretty much stay well in that maybe-ish kind of energy. By taking the soft language out, I am the owner of that in a way, as opposed to it owning me. And just as far as my professional practice goes, I'd say minimum 98% of the time that someone's using soft language to describe something, they take the soft language out and it's the truth. Yeah. And what that comes from, one of the things that comes from is fear of having a strong position. You know, what if I want to make sure everybody feels okay. Okay. And I said it in the seminar, same thing. If I play small to protect someone else's smallness, we both lose. Okay? So somebody's got to get on with it sooner or later.
The voice that is incessantly inside your mind doesn't bubble up. It's just there. What bubbles up is the emotions, because your inner seer wants to speak. It wants to tell the truth, but it's been trained to be covert. So you don't want to be caught, you don't want to be embarrassed, you don't want to be put in a position that you're going to have to face your own emotions. So that's why it bubbles up. When I'm speaking, my heart doesn't think, it just says. Once you go to your mind, you lose your heart. And many people bring their mind into the heart space as their confusion. Then your mind and your heart are caught in the same dilemma. You do need your thoughts to plan what you're going to do. You make your plans, but once you make your plans or you teach somebody in your business to do what they need to do, it becomes a routine, so then it's easier to turn it off. Having creative realizations and putting your energy into what you really love is more powerful than thoughts. So when you just listen to your own voice as you speak and you don't think about it, then there's only the truth of the moment, and then you begin to learn about the truth of your moments. Instead of living the scripted moment which you're trying to organize to define yourself. There was a point in our childhood where we were forced not to be silent, not to be truthful, not to be absolutely forthcoming. And once that happened, then the child starts to speak to themselves and starts to mimic the program which is given to them. Instead of you know how children are there, they're very straightforward, tell you what they see. And then they're punished to the point where they don't want to tell you what they're seeing anymore. So they make a promise to themselves that they just don't want to see it anymore because it's too painful. Their truth is too painful, their heart is too painful. So then they go to the social program and everybody's happy about being programmed. And there's you get forced into a very, very strange corner that you can't get out of.
If it's a mistake, then you know it's just, it's a mistake. If it's been done intentionally, okay, order out of chaos, let's thoroughly confuse the masses and then we'll control it. And if somebody or a group of somebodies got together and they thought up a code, a language that would completely and utterly disempower people, confuse them to no end, and to get them to make a bunch of pictures of what they don't want, which will further pollute their energy field, and over time really trash their physical body, then they nailed it. They totally nailed it. My Ayurvedic doctor used to say that the English language, to use the way it is by the common person, is a slave language. And now I get it, because it turns us into internal prisoners. Internal prisoners. And that's the sneakiest sort, because I look like I'm free. Especially to the ego mindset that only knows that single position. Because that single position has only run one kind of code.
We have gone sick by following a path of untrammeled rationalism, male dominance, attention to the visible surface of things, practicality, bottom lineism. We have gone very, very sick. And the body politic, like any body, when it feels itself to be sick, it begins to produce antibodies or strategies for overcoming the condition of dis-ease. And the 20th century is an enormous effort at self-healing. The society is trying to cure itself by an archaic revival, by a reversion to archaic values. And when you tease apart these archaic impulses, at the very center of all these impulses is the desire to return to a world of magical empowerment of feeling. That's what the world is. The world is not an unsolved problem for scientists or sociologists. The world is a living mystery. Our birth, our death, our being in the moment, these are mysteries. They are doorways opening on to unimaginable vistas of self-exploration, empowerment, and hope.
I strongly believe that people come to states of awakening and experiences of deep communion and connection with the universe simply by engaging the energy and space around them. We all day long are engaging with things physically. We're touching cups, we're touching tools, we're eating food, we're engaging with people. We're speaking and vibrating their eardrums. We're listening to what they say. We're taking on ideas and moving through those ideas in our own head. We're processing our own emotions, feeling our feelings in our bodies. But we take very little time to just sense all of those things, to just witness all of those things, and allow our senses to feed us more. We quiet our minds, we just sense on our skin, we listen to the air, we taste in our mouths, we smell, and we see. And when we stop condensing those things, we stop trapping them in thoughts and names and treating them as objects that we can touch, but instead just feel what's there, then all of a sudden we gain the benefit of all of this additional information that is inside of everything. The tree suddenly shows you its patterns. The sun coming through suddenly shines into fractals and you can see rainbows in the curves between the leaves. The bark itself takes on faces and ancient wisdom structures. The rocks begin to show you patterns of mountains and ages of time. And all of that is in everything all the time. It's in every person we look at, it's in the world around us, but it's when we begin to really allow ourselves to relax into the moment and really receive what the moment has to offer that suddenly a whole universe opens up. The whole world opens up for us to explore and discover. And it opens because we become energetically connected. We suddenly feel the radiance from the trees and let it penetrate us. We suddenly feel the tone of the rock and let it penetrate us. We allow in the energy that's flowing all around us. And through that allowing, we sense the field, and the field extends through everything.
And everything has this energetic fabric that's the universal tapestry, and all of the mystics, you know, talk to the cosmos as much as they, you know, talk to the stones. And the land gives us so many gifts if we slow down enough to listen. And then some people go, oh, I don't hear anything. What are you feeling inside of your body that gives you access to a new insight that wasn't there before? You don't have to hear the voices of the trees. Everybody accesses information in their own unique way. And some of it is claircognizant, which means you just get the download. And it feels like you. It doesn't feel like any external entity coming to talk to you, because you've already become one with that part of yourself, so you don't need the introduction in that way.
Everything you conceive of, you're connected to. It's a little bit funny to say that's not part of you or part of me, because it is. Everybody underestimates themselves, because you are part of everything. As soon as you connect your eyes to something, it begins to change on a very subtle level. It becomes you. Just because there's distance, air between us, you breathe the same air as me, your heart pumps the same blood. We are the birds that sing in the trees. We see them with our ears before we see them with our eyes. We are our environment, and our environment is us.
This whole conversation, every word that comes out of my mouth, I go home, I come back and say something out loud. See what I mean? Transpiring between you and I, we're traveling, and yet we're fully present here. There's an age-old saying in the mystery schools, I am here and I am there. It's one and the same. I'm fully present to you, and I'm also in all those altered states of consciousness simultaneously. That's ultimately the blessing of what we're capable of. And all of these different ways of invoking that connection and communication are strengthening that bridge between worlds. And so sometimes, you know, I have star kids going, even the paint on the wall is talking to me. The molecules of light in the wall is talking to me. You know, and they think like they're on, you know, what is that stuff called? Acid, or, you know, that's actually our natural state. You've just gone into a what we call transcendental meditation state of your life.
You shift, so you begin to see. Then when you begin to see, you realize that the construct in front of you is malleable. It's not as real as what it seems to be, because you get an overlay, and the overlay gives you information. And that's what it's all about, leaving ourselves so that we can become something other than ourselves. And when we realize that there's a image or images, holographic images which have been denied us. Once you see that the information comes to you, then you've got no choice but to interpret it in a way that it's meant to be seen. There are many different ways of seeing. I see you when I feel you. I see you when I hear you speaking. I see you when I touch you. I see you when I taste the food you cook. I see you when your energy field has got something in it. I see your gestures. You observe everything with your energy field. So you don't have to look at it to observe it. Observation is done with all of our senses. When people come and visit me sometimes, I see the luminous bubble. And it's just clear like water. And if the person's intending to leave when they're coming, if they're giving me something, the bubble goes back in on itself. So it gives me the information, shows me exactly what they're going to do. This is just a very rough example. So I know the person's leaving, so I don't invite them inside, because I can see their energy bubble. But every time that I meet someone, I don't see their energy bubble, I'll see something else. So you have to learn to wait. You have to forego the idea that you're going to know. And you can't really know anything if you decide you're going to know something, because then you've scripted yourself to actually see what you want to see instead of seeing what you're meant to see. And if you think it should be a certain way, then you'll just see the world the way it normally is. When you see it, it's different. And to do that, you have to be empty inside yourself. everybody has the possibility to be quiet, to be fully engaged in something which can't be engaged with, and that's a contradiction. Everybody has this possibility. You just have to wake up to it, to realize it. And the way you realize it is when you switch yourself off. Someone will sit down, they'll be inactive, but they'll be thinking to themselves, they'll be feeling, they'll be planning, they'll be regretting, doing all these social things, plotting and planning, doing what they have to do. Then there's complete silence. So, you just gave an example. If everyone can hear that you just did a breath in and a breath out. This wasn't a silent breath. So if you breathe in and you breathe out silently, then you watch your breath go in and you witness your breath come out. So you command your eyes to go in quietly and go out quietly. So your senses are following something that can't be heard. So that's silent. So if you don't listen and you watch your breath, then your internal dialogue switches off. If you listen to the breath, then you huff and puff and blow someone's house down, the big ego get cranky. If you listen to it, then it's just like having an internal dialogue. And yeah, so there's a shock to your body. That's pure silence. So you're laughing about something so ridiculous, and it's really funny. So that's just witnessing your body consciousness in terms of your silence. You can be silent and absolutely blissful at the same time. So then you're totally engaged in level of feeling, and there's nothing else there. There's no thought but the joy of just being in the room. And can you feel it? What's in the air? Yeah. This is what we've all forgot. What's in the room at the moment? And your social self can't survive with this amount of silence in the room. We're changing, and we're changing really rapidly. And I'm just take you back to your own experience. Your change is so rapid, the silence that you've experienced is so profound that you're actually saying, well, I don't want to lose this when I leave. You won't lose it. And you're wondering, where was it before you got here? And that's the change that's going on. People are realizing, you're crying. Yeah. You're remembering yourself, that's it. But he's crying because his application to life has been opposite to what he's realizing. So the seer inside cries. Not out of unhappiness, but because you're at the moment remembering yourself. And at the same time, realizing that the way you lived has not really been who you really are. So when you discover yourself, it's not quite often people cry. And that's what an agu is. You ask the question, what's an agu? To bring people to a threshold of silence so they can find themselves. Once you've found yourself, then your journey really begins. You don't have to be like I am. You have to be like you are. And your true power comes to the surface. And that's how you overcome your conundrums. Be yourself. And you know without doubt, with absolute certainty, what can't be explained.
Nobody understands what is happening. Not Buddhists. Not Christians, not government scientists, no one understands what is happening. So forget ideologies. They betray, they limit, they lead astray. Just deal with the raw data and trust yourself. Nobody is smarter than you are. And what if they are? What good is their understanding doing you? Inform yourself. What does inform yourself mean? It means A, transcend and mistrust ideology. Go for direct experience. What do you think when you face the waterfall? What do you think when you have sex? What do you think when you take psilocybin? Everything else is unconfirmable rumor, useless, probably lies. So liberate yourself from the illusion of culture. Take responsibility for what you think and what you do.
You begin to watch yourself, and as you watch yourself, you become aware of other people. And as you become aware of other people, you begin to be totally absorbed in what really needs to happen. When I look at you, I look into my heart at the same time. And as I look into my heart, I feel you while I see you. So you become me and I become you. You go back to the point where you feel vulnerable, and then you express yourself from that vulnerability by being of service to people and loving yourself through loving other people, and be silent and be non-violent. And then you honestly come to terms with yourself.
How could we possibly take an action against another human being and not feel the impact of it? So all these questions of where does that like split happen? When a being loses the connection to their source consciousness in their body, then they forget how to be in respect with their relations. And the greatest challenge here is the forgetting. And that the point was to bring tools and resources, initiations, what you call medicine, to help us remember who we are, who I am, who you are, so that those atrocities that have transpired for thousands of years can like go out of style. You know, it's like, why would you ever take an action against yourself if you actually remembered that I am you in Lakesh?
Just imagine Jesus is on the cross. And he says, oh my God, why do you forsake me? These words have separated you from your own identity. You identify with the power beyond you instead of the power within you. So these words are crucial to create separation. And the idea that we're less than what we are, and something else has ultimate control over our destiny, which this is not true. We have ultimate control over our destiny. We are our hearts. The Aramaic language has a different understanding to the way it's been interpreted. And even when it was interpreted into Aramaic, how do you know that's what was said? Now, just say he was on the cross, and instead of saying, oh my God, why do you forsake me? Oh my Father. Didn't he really say, oh my beloved, why do you forsake me? When he said, oh my beloved, why do you forsake me? He was saying, oh my heart of hearts, the heart of another crucifies me. Why does another heart harm me? My heart is in with you, and your heart is within me. My heart of hearts. Oh my beloved, why do you forsake me? Oh my heart, why do you injure me? It's the truth. Then we become connected to the most profound union there is, our hearts, in what we do to each other. So when you crucify someone, or you crucified yourself, you understand that the heart of another is totally misunderstood. That you are inside of me and I am inside of you. And would you hurt yourself? Of course not. And that's why it's so very important to come to terms with our inevitability as human beings. The very last thing that we'll be looking for at the end of our life is our beloved, the heart that we have within another. If we can't find that heart, then we die alone. So So we best live with the idea of our inevitability and cultivate this preciousness.
The highlights of the journey to coming into the place where we're at now. I will not say the place where we're at now. I will say the place where we have been and that we are learning how to shift from. We came there, we got there, mostly from small choices, one by one choices, moments in time in which we faced traumas, we faced challenges, we faced inner battles, and for the most part, it's individuals who have had the experience of their power being taken away, oftentimes as a child, by a parent, by a teacher. And as their power is taken away, they compensate because they try to take their power back, which is not something that you can actually do. You can only recognize that your power is not taken away. It is never gone in the first place. When you try to take your power back, you end up taking power from other people. That's the same pattern of response that happens and has happened over and over and over and over again throughout time. And the conditioning involved with that, you know, as we've grown up as a species and as we've come into this modern age and civilization as it has been, the levels of complexity by which we have patterned our process of taking power from other people is just phenomenal. And to remove that curse, to clear that pattern, we have to go back to the place of recognition that our power never gets taken away and that we are our power. You can't take away the I am. You can't take away me. The moment we stop blaming other people, other things, blaming the world outside of us for our own pain, our illness, our challenges in the physical world, that's the moment we take our power back. That's the moment it becomes ours to change. We choose responsibility, and we have the ability to respond and to change it completely. If you are having an intense emotional experience and you just mulling it and you eat your ice cream and you just swamp it and just want to cry and you want to watch sad movies, you're just perpetuating a vibrational field and you're really ignoring the fact that you can look at yourself. But the moment you look at yourself, you move up the spectrum. You're like, oh, I'm doing all of this. I'm creating all of this pain. I'm creating all of this sorrow. I can take responsibility for it. Suddenly things change. Now you're responsible for the fact that you're dwelling in your misery, and you can still choose to do it, but you can also choose to change it. You're empowered suddenly. And many people have forgotten that they have that power.
You know, when we start to really investigate where my feelings of embarrassment are, which are in my body, and where my who was thinking my thoughts of whatever the concept was that embarrassed me. Okay, I'm thinking my thoughts. Wait a minute, I embarrassed me. So I project out, you embarrassed me. No, wrong. Impossible. And that mindset is insane, you know? Because someone can come up to me if I operate from that mindset, that position, and say something to me that I've said 1,000 times to myself, internally, to myself, about myself. And I lash out at them for something that I've been saying to myself for years. That's called being insane. That's an insane mind. And so if someone says something to me and I have an emotional, energetic reaction, that's because part of me agrees with them. Okay? And if I want to defend this egotistic reality, then I'm going to call them an enemy. A lot of it happens on the playground. You know, some kid walks up and does this, and the other kid cries, and you did this to me. And a lot of people are still operating in that, from that position. If I'm operating from the position of truth and I want to continue to peel the onion, then once my ego is screamed a little bit and I've stuck a pacifier in its mouth and done the processes, then that person's my friend. They've just assisted me in seeing and uncovering the next layer of my illusion. And when someone gets to a point where they get a little bit nauseous, they have a cringe factor when they're projecting heavily because they know what that feels like, because they know what the other side of the street feels like, then staying out of the rumor mill is just that easy. And that's fantastic because, it's a bunch of lies. What am I doing when I'm engaged in that? Am I defining that other person? No, I'm defining myself. I'm talking about myself. And I'm defining myself as a person that judges.
There's a lot of people that think that they're really, really awake. And then what a lot of us are experiencing right now is like we might be confronted, with our deepest fears. And in that humbling experience, we can ask for help. There has to be that mutuality and the recognition that, in 2012, we're really all in this together. And I don't care if you're a world famous expert on XYZ, human species has never been at the point of our growth and development that we're at right now. So thank you for your expertise. And yet, can we all just say, I walk forward with you, in this great expanse, not necessarily predicting the outcome because we can't.
The tools you've got now, you'll take home with you. You'll develop your own inner silence by yourself. You'll develop your power in your body by yourself. I can't do that for you. I'll never take control of your person. You'll always be in command of that. This is your life. It's your life path. And no one should be in somebody else's life to the point that they direct their eyes to go where the person demands. This is not good. You've got to allow people to see what they need to see in their own circumstances. And maybe when they come back or they get absorbed in more silence, then the silence itself will make the person realize where their life path is going. I don't need to really tell you once you gather a certain amount of power. And if there's any confusing points, I'll give you the tool to see that. I don't keep the tool to make you dependent on me, because that's ripping you off from your own life path. That's criminal. That's why I'm not a guru.
People don't need me or anyone else to be a crutch. And actually, that's, again, old paradigm stuff. Follow me, I'll be your guru, And what is guru? G-U-R-U. It's like, that's it, So drop all the other stuff. Don't overlay it on anyone else. It's about us as individuals. We're the ones making the change. Yeah, every once in a while, we need a little nudging on or a little poke or a little flip of the switch. But what you're looking for is within you. All the validation, all the love, all the nurturing, all the fostering of these energies that we are is within you. And so it's not about this guy that's, saying all the right stuff. Take it, listen to it, own it for yourself, make it into your thing, make it work for you, whatever that means, and then share that energy.
Anytime we're waiting for Jesus or the Galactic Federation or Pee Wee Herman, any of these to save us, then we're losing the ability to actually gain the real knowledge that those systems offer. And Jesus wasn't all about it. I mean, if you look at it, if you really read the Red Writing, he was saying, you're already saved. Just, do you believe you're saved? There you go. How's that feel? Good. Now go and do your work. And all of the great, great mystics have given this message that you're already saved, you're already here, so now get back to the business of living with the idea that you're saved.
You take responsibility for your circumstances, and you can put your energy into that by taking responsibility and fully being empowered by what you're doing. Or you can take the power from the circumstance and not take full responsibility, not say what needs to be said, not care where you need to care. Be kind, be understanding, and forget yourself and forget your own need to validate yourself. Then you'll discover that you've found something inside of other people that wants to reflect itself back in you. And when you get rid of the social drama, you can really begin to enjoy the people in your environment.
When someone gets clear about how they want to feel, that's the stepping stone. And the past is what it was. How you feel about the past is what you are now. Okay? And that position, that concept, that belief system, if I'm thinking back 20 years to something and I'm feeling now, then that's now. And so what do I want to do about the now? If I change how I feel about that now, we can change our definition about what that was and what we were back then and what those people were doing to us, which was actually what they were doing to themselves, and change our whole psychological position on it. Okay? And have a better story. Because this whole thing's a story. All of it. The whole thing. It's one big story. And if we're going to be in a big story like that, and we're writing the story as we go, then let's see how great of a story we can have.
Our relationships aren't just, me and my significant other and my sacred union partner, or me and my family, or me and my friends, and me and acquaintances. It's me and my world. It's how I relate. Okay, so relationship is what is your relationship to your world, to your reality, to your experience? And so for us, it's all about looking inside and just really kind of stopping all the other stuff and saying, okay, what else is going on in there? What are my belief systems? My belief systems are up here. They create my reality, validating my belief systems, taking us back to belief systems. You shift any little aspect of a belief system, your experience of reality is going to back up that belief system. So you all of a sudden shift from I'm not deserving to I am deserving. Everything's going to change. So whenever something happens that isn't validating for me, or validating in a negative way, you know, or creates what I call a less than comfortable experience, which is a constriction or a, ooh, that was odd, you know, whatever that is, kind of experience. I want to spend some time, you know, in there, seeing where that comes from and what belief system is that.
It all comes down to our personal relationship with reality. What we put out, we get back. It's all this balance. The whole monetary system, the political system, it's all based on that. And so as long as we're looking for an escape, then we will also be enslaved. You can't escape if you're not enslaved. And if we're looking for someone to save us, then we're going to prove that we need to be saved, that we're incapable of remedy on our own.
You return home and release the sphere of the rolling mirror. You come into clarity in yourself. And that clarity reveals to all of us what we are responsible for. And at different levels, we recognize the vast nature of that responsibility. Yet we still must choose every moment how much of that we're going to accept and how much of that we're going to choose not to be conscious of for now. I can choose not to be conscious or responsible for the temperature in the air right now. I can choose to not be conscious or responsible for the beating of my heart. I can choose not for the tree. I can choose not for the sun. I can choose not for the galaxy. I can choose not for all of humanity. And choose not to be responsible for all that humankind is going through. That is my choice. And I am given that choice. And that is free will. And it's beautiful. It's beautiful that I can choose to be small. But it is also beautiful when I choose to be large. And I begin to accept that this moment and this temperature and this tree and the sun and that all of the changes happening on the planet right now are happening in part because of me right now. And it's not ego. It's not, I'm the dude, you know, I'm God, I'm the like avatar, you know, like the whole planet's counting on me. It's not about that. It's about me recognizing that the potency exists inside of me to help everyone shift into a place of greater awareness and consciousness. And all I have to do is choose to embody all of that and shift it in myself. And I can help so many people in vast and incredible ways. And we must do that with each other. We must bring each other into that space of responsibility. Because we need rest too. We need time while we're on this physical plane to be unconscious, to let the awareness and the responsibility fade.
In some spiritual traditions, they refer to impeccability as gnosis, direct knowing, not that which I believe, that which I have remembered and know in my heart of hearts. Impeccability is also embodiment. Now that I have this knowingness, now that I have this remembrance, in each and every moment, what is my choice of how I'm going to express this divine truth? In my actions, in my choices, in my behaviors, and in my words. From the near-death experience perspective, it's called the life review. And you witness the impact of every choice and every decision that you've ever had. And knowing that what you create in that reflection is felt 100%, no gap whatsoever. The impeccability of the golden rule. You know, treating you with the respect and reverence that I would like to receive and not having a gap in the registering. As I step into my heart and I set a pattern in play, and that pattern comes from loving benevolence, you feel elevated, you feel inspired, you feel enriched. And even if I took an action that challenged you, you know, or pushed your buttons, if you could still feel that the purity of my intent was love, that at the root of every choice and decision, I was invested in your freedom and in your liberty and in your joy as much as I was in my own, that I'm living in that impeccability of the unified field. So impeccability is linked to impact, because when you stop karma, there's no longer cause and effect, because you already get the impact. So then you don't put out a cause wave that would create something that isn't, you know, aligned with the impeccability of your heart's truth. Now that's an extremely esoteric concept. However, make it simple. In this now moment, what is the chain reaction that my presence is creating in my immediate environment? So for people, it can be as simple as, how courageous was I in that living moment? It takes courage to make a choice from love. And it's just kind of like, does it feel good? Have you left an interaction leaving a positive feeling? Or, you know, have I slipped back into, you know, some old program or some old conditioning or some old ancestral habituation, basically, that's just like passing on, you know, the garbage, rather than being my authentic self. So where people have, you know, those schisms, it's where they're not in impeccable right relationship with themselves, and then they just play out, you know, that dynamic with another.
If there's nothing really to put your heart to, then you watch what the circumstance brings you, and you view exactly what's going on, and you'll be directed whether it's appropriate to put your integrity there or to watch with your integrity intact. So it's you just watch the play in front of you. And either withdraw softly or participate appropriately. Either way, it's a participation. Watching something from your own integrity changes the event just through the observance of it. But if you watch that event without your integrity and you're fully programmed, then you don't have the same effect because it feeds into it. If you expect something and the other person doesn't have this expectation, you're actually manipulating them on the level of energy to comply. And it's like a very subtle form of violence until everyone gets into a position where everyone's playing this game. And then you begin to learn about the people that are around you. And there'll be some who'll give you without expectations, and there'll be some who'll give to you with hidden expectations. And that's a form of violence because it's not forecoming. It's doing everybody harm. There is a point where you can't tell and be transparent to someone that you know is really going to hurt you. But the people who really matter, you can start to be forthcoming with until it spreads to the point that there'll be a mass of people going to maybe someone that can't deal with the truth. They have to deal with it because there'll be a collective energy saying, well, don't do this because it's really not right for all of us. And then you begin to process what you really need to do, what's fundamentally right for the real circumstances and not for the agenda behind the circumstances that have been set up. If you're transparent, you have a battle. A real battle. If you're not transparent, then you have another battle. You can have a battle to reinforce your social self, and this is what everybody's doing, or you can have a battle to undo everything that's socially being programmed so that you can live the moment that's right in front of you and express the truth and have the strength and courage to express the truth. If everyone made the decision to be transparent, then the real battle would be at foot. The reality of what really needs to be done, what really needs to be achieved. They're both battles, that the one's spinning the wheels in terms of personal growth and personal realizations. I mean, people can have personal growth and personal realizations in terms of manifesting something, but it's the manifestation of within that we really all need to have a close look at so that we can begin to heal ourselves and the planet through our personal interactions.
An empowered individual in touch with their own existential core can do what that guy did with the 18 tanks. It was an idea that stopped the tanks, and it was an idea expressed not over state radio, not through the newspapers, but by one person taking a stand. And this is what we all need to realize. We are responsible for ourselves, and we will set the agenda for the human future. We're not going to learn it from Der Spiegel, from Time magazine. It doesn't come like that. Direct experience. Your experience, your opinion, your feelings, your sexuality is the only real thing in your universe. Don't transfer loyalty to ideology, to money, to party, to friends. All of these things are outside of the core of your reality, and centuries of programming have been laid on to all of us to take away the power of our own direct experience. They do not want people to take back their minds. Yeah. And we're going to take back our minds soon.
How can we go any other way? We've been doing it a little bit wrong. And this little bit wrong is having huge consequences. So you have to try and do it a little bit more right. And then your truth becomes apparent. And then there's less to say and more to do.